being a regulation of the to be part of the speaking and the university that allowed to be a part of and making a professional link for finding the end. And it might be a lot of the other cases that we put together. It might be the one that I'm glad that I can achieve it. And actually, like, made me like, feel like I can do anything after graduating from the university. So the topic that I'm going to talk about is the doctrine of education. Actually, like, from the outside, I'm not the born educator. I'm actually like, graduated from MBA engineering background. I don't have like education background at all. So I speak from the view of the outsider. Actually, I do not dare to disrupt education, but I share my view about how education transforming what I see education going forward. But before that, like, let me tell you a little bit about me. This is me like 29 years ago. You can see like how old I am. I was born and raised in Kampangket. It's a small province in the northern part of Thailand. I was born like very small, and I attended school 2 years earlier than the other kids, so I was small. And my dad came back home like only 2 times a year because he worked for the Royal Land Development Department. He worked for developing a land in the borderland of China for the king, His Majesty the King Rama IX. And so he came back home only like twice a year. So I was not confident. I was small, and I was still big. Very sweet. Actually, I would say I'm still stupid, not really smart. But back then, I wasn't really stupid. I was the not really a smart kid. Imagine, small kid, not so confident. Father came back home and only twice a year. And then you chase school all the times. You didn't have any confidence at all. And then, it was so lucky of me that I met one teacher that initiated my life. Her name is Ajahn Jantar Sonarai. She's like a high school teacher, ordinary teacher at Wat Phu Yang. It's like Wat Phu Yang is like a typical school, but then like she totally changed my life. I couldn't have imagined I would come this far without her at all. But she taught me one thing. Education, first thing, is all about empathy. This is like only at Wat Phu Yang where I graduated. You know, it's like a typical school. The first thing is all about empathy. Putting the student at the center, try to empathize. What is empathy? Empathy is seeing with the eyes of another, listening with the ears of another, and feeling with the heart of another. I still remember to this day, the first moment she saw me, very small kid, have no friend at all, just entered the school, she hugged me. She hugged me, that hug, very, very warm hug. She was my first friend at that school. And she gave me confidence. She listened to me, she tried to understand me. And then, you know, like she taught me pretty, believe me, you can do anything in the world. It sounds cheesy, but that moment, imagine a kid, very young kid, that means the whole world. It gives like a proof of confidence. Someone believes in me. It matters so much. Empathy? See the world through my eyes, she tried to understand, appreciate me as a human being, not as a student. She tried to understand my feeling, my loneliness, and everything. She tried to communicate with me. She have lunch with me every single day. She have lunch with me every single day. And then she told me, I noticed one thing. When you say something, when you pronounce higher, you have like a very good tongue. You have a very good tongue. You can pronounce Rorua very good. Why everyone, the rest of the class is busy, studying, small kid, still there. Not good at anything, but Ajahn Jantar saw this. The only white spot in the whole thing, when you look at this, what do you see? You see a complete pitch black. But she see a bright spot. She see a potential for the star. So she said, you have that one thing, very, very good, impressive. Try, practice it. Okay, rolling. Okay, now, rolling. Now, okay, try to read the whole paragraph. And then, like, she sent me, after practicing the L-Alphabet, you know, she sent me to the competition at the provincial level. I won second place in the provincial level at reading time. I get the whole confidence of that competition to change my life. It's sad, but she already passed away. The teacher that changed my life. She saw the brightest spot out of the whole, you know, pitch black canvas. The role of the teachers or anyone in education system, the first thing is to empathize with your student. Put them at the center. Try to see the bright spot. Try to see the stars among the night sky. This is me, you know. And then I won like a third scholarship. And later, 3 years later, I get a confidence. I become like, you know, quite popular among friends, start to play soccer. And then I realize, you know, actually it's not my strength at all, reading time. It's just the first step. But it is the most important step, you know, that a tantan called, like, try to make me make a baby step, you know. But that's the very important baby step. I just realized later by another teacher at Wat Phuyan as well, a tantan Chin Chong. He's still teaching at Wat Phuyan. You know, he taught me science. He taught me science. The way he taught science is like this, you know. He taught like the surface tension, the concept of surface tension. Wat Phuyan back then is a school that doesn't have any equipment. It doesn't have any like laboratory devices at all. But he never gave up teaching the students. He taught me the surface tension by bringing the student outside and looking at the water spider walking on the surface of the water. This is how we teach surface tension. He teach electromagnetism. He teach like everything. He teach to take the part of the bicycle apart, and then like we get the magnetics, you know, like that's how we teach like magnetism. And then I realized, wow, science is really amazing. It just everywhere. And then he like, you know, like he inspired me that pretend science is logic. Science is the language of God. Science is the mechanism where God created the universe. It's everywhere. If you know science, if you master science, you can understand the logic of the God. I'm like, holy crap! You know that moment, like, let me change my life. And it actually inspires so much. So the second step of anyone in education is about inspiration. Don't teach subject matter. Empathize with them and inspire them. That's the first thing. Inspiration is more important than anything. And then you know what? He tell me that, you know, if you want to be someone who is very good at science, you know, the most important thing, you may want to set your goal to win the gold medal in Physics Olympic, win the gold medal in science competition in Thailand. I said, what? You know what? I don't understand. I didn't know about that at all. No one in Kampanget province ever won that. I said like, and then how can I win that? You know, I'm not that smart. He said, Pratim, what did you learn from Chan Chan Thong? Confidence. And then he said like, you know what? You may not be the smartest one, but you are the most intellectually curious. Once you are inspired, the second thing is that the educator has to make you feel curious. Curiosity. And the next step is all about exploration. He doesn't really teach me subject matter at all, but he helped me explore many, many subjects. And then like, I start to feel like, hey, this is amazing. Science is amazing. I start to do exploration on my own. I read books in the library. And analysis is your part of inspiration, self-exploration. It leads to passion. I woke up at 4 a.m. in the morning every single day, and I do like 5,000 like you know 5,000 mathematics like problems, 5,000 mathematics problems like, because of passion, because I'm so curious, I'm so inspired, and I'm confident. And then I learn how that 6 year hard work, time isn't much about passion. Without passion. Started in number one in the mathematics competition, or we know physics for me, be the first in my provinces. I'm not smart, I would say like one of the most stupid in my class. But I'm a talent, a master in passion. I never give up. But it always comes from confidence, inspiration, and passion. And this is me. And then, luckily, I was among the first in my provinces to be able to attend Chulalongkorn University. The other thing that I learned, the thing that gave me the most from Chulalongkorn University, actually is apart from world-class professor and subject matter, that's something that is really important. But the most important thing is our community. It's our peer. Your peer and your community help you learn. They bring the best of you and then they push you forward. I was marked like a, I was considered like a, okay, a good student from my provinces. When I came to Jula, I became the most favorite one. I still remember I was not being rejected. I was got like a little fire from Chulalongkorn University because my GPA was like almost below 2 at one point. Almost below 2. But then like, you know, eventually I met this professor and then I helped me graduate. But then I graduated with the honor, but it's like very difficult. But then I learned that like, the peer and the community means a lot. And that's what Chulalongkorn University taught me. This is me, and this is me, you know, like, it doesn't look like me at all, like, I used to look pretty good, I think. And then the other thing that I think is very important about, you know, like, education, I joined one company, I think it's a very good company, like, P&G. P&G is one of the top three companies that create the most number of, the highest number of CEOs in the world, you know. So it's a very, very good school. I graduated from Chulalongkorn University, one of the top school, engineering school with honor. Very arrogant, you know, and I survived Professor Pandit, you know, so I said like, I'm okay, I must be smart a little bit, you know. So I joined P&G, but the first job that P&G gave me the honor, students, graduated from Chulalongkorn University, electrical engineering, is to make a shampoo. Make a shampoo, your job. And it's not like controlling the whole like, shampoo manufacturing system, but optimizing the turbine to make a shampoo. My job is so simple. Find the speed of the turbine that makes a shampoo so that it doesn't create like a bubble. I said like, oh, this is so simple job, you know, this is so simple job, I'll make it. And then I screw it up. 12 kinds of shampoo, a lot of bubble, and 12 kinds of shampoo, we are talking about several million baht of shampoo that got wasted. I have to throw it away down the drain. I was shocked. I thought I would be fired from P&G. I said like, okay, I probably need to find a new job. And this is like only 3 months into the job, just graduate. My confidence level will go down. Before that, I was so arrogant, and now like my confidence level just go down, you know. And you know, I was like, the whole world was like falling upon me. But eventually, I talked to my boss. My boss said like, "This is okay. That's okay. Calm down." I was crying, you know. I was crying. My boss said like, "The world is not falling apart. Stay up. Calm down. Go back to the manufacturing plant." What did you learn? I said, okay, first step, go back to the field, use YY analysis, use a root cause analysis, that kind of thing, that's what you learn. Okay, so I use that, okay, and then come back, this seems to be a problem. He said, that's okay. I said, like, are you sure you're not going to fire me? No, we are not going to fire you. And he said, go back. This is a root cause, right? The root cause is from the O-ring. The O-ring was broken. And then like, so that's why he got me into the plant. And then he said, that's okay. Then how can we prevent it? He said, are you sure you're not going to find me yet? No, don't worry. And I said like, okay, the O-ring, so we need to inspect the O-ring first. We probably run with water first, that kind of thing. And the professor said, my manager said, hey, this is good. Okay, this is good. Why don't you write a standard operating practices? Why don't you write a standard operating practices? And then you deploy, communicate to the rest of the plant all over the world about this. Are you sure? you're not firing me yet? I said, I was ready to be fired from him. He said, no, don't worry. In PNG, that's why we call learning organization. We learn from mistake. We learn from mistake. Failure is the mother of success. And the best education system. And then I entered Google. I worked for Google in Silicon Valley. And that's what I use at Google as well. Google is one of the most innovative companies on earth. And I realized why. And this is my project. Again, it's like launching a 3D map of the moon to celebrate the 40th anniversary of the moon landing. You know? And because we have to launch exactly on that day, because it's a day like 40 years ago, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin set foot on the moon at the first time, so we celebrate 40th anniversary. So we have a hard deadline to launch the software. And imagine what happened. This is what happened. 8 hours before the launch. This is the surface of the moon. And look at that. It's the size of Toyota office. And 8 hours I need to fix it. You know? 8 hours I need to fix it. But after my failure with PNG, I feel like I can deal with anything, you know? I can deal with anything. You know, I screw up like 12 times a champion. So what the hell? This is simple. Failure is the mother of success. And at Google, we celebrate failure as much as success. And then we face it, and then it was so successful. And then, this is Neil Armstrong, and this is the director of the NASA. And we invited the second man on the moon as well, Buzz Aldrin. It was successful. It wouldn't have been successful at all if I had not been facing failure at PNG. Failure is the mother of success. Failure is just a part of success. That's why great education or learning system and Google, this is all the product at Google that failed. Google Bus, Google Wave, blah, 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 blah. And even right now, the Google Bus is a failure as well. But Google doesn't care, they keep innovating. They say failure is part of the learning process. You can't say you are going to disrupt education at all if you don't change the culture of celebrating failure and accept failure as part of the process. But what you learn out of the failure? In startup, I came from the world of startup. In startup, we have a motto called fail fast to succeed faster. You fail first, you fail fast, and then you learn fast, you get up, and you succeed faster. Because at Google, we create a sandbox, it's a safe environment to try and fail without penalty. How about our country? When you fail, what happened? It sticks with you all the time. It seems so simple, but it's very difficult to change. I tried to change that for 4 years. It changed a little bit, but it's very difficult. So that's why I apply that to my learning. Create a sandbox, a safe environment for people to try and fail. A sandbox, something similar. Think about a kid, they try to create something and then they fail, that's okay. And the failure is contained in the sandbox. And I realized the whole thing, great education is similar to design thinking process. First, it starts with empathize. You empathize with the user. In this case, you empathize with the students. What is empathy? Again, look at their world from their view and hear them. Think of them as human first. Don't think of them as students. In some part, in some university up here, they can think of students as customer. That's stupid. Never think of students as customer at all. Empathize for them as a human being. What is their pain point? What do they need to deal with? What do they feel? Try to look at them from their world. Empathize. Second step is define. Define their problems. And try to help them to explore the possibilities. And inspire them. This is the most important thing. Ideate. And then prototype. And then test. And then go back again. Education is a continuous improvement as well. It's not you design a curriculum and then you set it in stone for the next 5 years. It's not that. Because the world is moving so fast. like engineering education. When you enter school, when you graduate, what you learn is already outdated, right? You learn like the programming languages, and then like your graduates is already outdated because the world moves so fast. And you have to change, you have to think of education system as like a startup, running a startup. You ideate, you prototype the curriculum, and then you test, and then iterate, learn as well. And sometimes you have to admit that education sometimes can make mistakes as well, but then you get up and then learn. What is the design thinking principle? Understand your customer again, cross your customer, understand your students. And for those that are in the management position of education, understand your teaching as well. What is that aim for? Observe the world with their eyes. Prototyping. And then collaborate. Co-create with the students. This is very important. The education, not only the curriculum, delivery, and assessment, has to be co-created by the students as well. And I think Toronto Law University, by having a very strong, robust alumni network, co-create and prototype the curriculum with the alumni, and then partner, and then prepare and build failure into the process. This is all about changing the culture. Changing the culture. How do you celebrate failure as much as success? How do you not penalize failure of those who are in the education system? And incorporate the end-to-end user experience. What is the customer journey? What is the customer journey? Since the first, until the end. What is the customer journey from end to end of the education and learning process? And I would say that for education system right now, there's no end. The second end, there's no end. Because you have to learn all the time. So this is like, so I use the design thinking process to create the a startup education program. When I came back from Silicon Valley in 2012, I used the design thinking process to start a course to teach startup in Thailand to build a startup ecosystem. And at first, I have like 20 students, and they run it like a, now it's already 10 batches, and they run it like a startup. Every single batches are different. So we have like a traditional lecture as well. We have like a workshop. And right after they learn the concept, they do it right away. They create a startup right away after they learn. They learn 1 hour and then prototyping their ideas, and then they test it. We teach them from finding ideas, building a prototype, creating a business model, and then pitching to investors. And we force them, some of them never present at all. Some of them was very, very shy. So they say, like, we create a safe environment for them. Whatever happened there, to stay there. So for some of them, like, Before the class, we were so shy, they were engineers, they were geek, you know. After the class, you know, like they're one of the best teachers. Some of them already got funding. Like several 10 million baht funding. Imagine that how people can be transformed in a short period of time. When you push people to do something and give them the environment to try and fail and learn, they can make a miracle. And the other thing is all about community. Learning is all about community as well, like to create a robust community. Right now we have a community of 800 students that like help each other. And inside thinking, we are talking about like have a people at the center, right? We create an education system that is desirable and beneficial for people. Technology must be feasible and it must be viable as well. That's what I think. But then we see like we are trying to apply design thinking process to education system to disrupt it. We talk about people a lot, empathize, define, ideate. And then we say like, is it really feasible to disrupt education? Professor Bandi already said a lot about the using technology to empower teachers and democratize education. Is it going to be a good business? I can tell you in advance. I run a fund, $15.4 million. I have prepared $3 million, 100 million baht to invest in a tech startup. anyone in this group come up with a good tech startup idea, just come pitch me right after this. I have a blank check for you. 100 million baht for that. Why do I need it? Look at this. This is like an evolution of learning. Look at Plato or Thaleman. That's like training. They need 7 years before Christ. So ancient. Fathers, imagine. And then we democratize learning a little bit, big Gutenberg press, so that people have like something to read, right? Create a book and everything. Knowledge is democratized. Everyone can read knowledge that at first got contained among the elite. And then we have a modern classroom. But look at that. It doesn't change that much. Yeah. 1,000 years, education never changed. When you look at this picture, like when you look from the view of startup, we see this industry is ready to be disrupted. It has never changed at all. It has never changed at all. Think about like a guy like Elon Musk. Auto has never been changed at all 100 years, so then like I go there and then disrupt. When it never changed, what happened? The incumbent, the existing player, they are lazy and complacent. Because they don't have to change. Right? That's the point. Everyone doesn't change. And everyone do the same. You don't need to evolve at all. But not this university. This university is adaptive and innovative. But think about it. The other university, I don't need to change. But when you look at it, the world has changed so much. The computing power in my cell phone, Samsung Galaxy A7, is more than the full computing power of NASA that sent the man to the moon. Think about it. I have an access to information 1,000 times more than the president of the United States when he fought the Cold War in Russia. Think about it. But education never changed. It is ready to be disrupted. And then second, look at the massive market. It's a $1 trillion market. Oh, very small, we are in $1 trillion. You are multiplied by 35. 35 million baht in US alone. And in China, how big is the market? You get the revenue of AIS, DTAC, and True, three mobile operators, and times 5. And times 5. That's how big is that market. Think about the English education market alone. How big is it? How big is it? And how about like the other professional education, kid education, preschool education? And education system in this country is so efficient. It's very powerful. Our education system right now generates a kid that has like a decreasing score of PISA. We are now probably at the same level as Tanzania, you know? Think about it. And then look at that. For COVID education is $130 billion. And online learning is expected to double to $65 billion in these 5 years. The market is big, it's never changed. Existing player are lazy, they don't want to change. Huge margin. There's a good opportunity for disruptors, for someone to change it, to build a good business. If you look at that, and also investors all over the world believe education is ready to be disrupted and build a good business. Why? They put $3.4 billion to invest in edtech education. And by 2020, $10 billion funding will go to edtech startup. People believe the next Google, the next Facebook will come from edtech. Education is not sexy at all. Education is not sexy. You know what? I think you can make it sexy. You know, you can make it sexy. This is huge business. Existing player lazy is growing, and investors is pouring money into education technology. No leaders. You look at communication, right? You look at like the internet. Who's the leader right now? You have Google, Facebook, you have Amazon. There are the leaders. But in education, who's the biggest player in education technology? The finance is the answer. There's no leader, there's a tons of opportunity to make this industry sexy again. And knowledge never mentioned. The social web is the most disruptive changes to learning since the 19th century. This is once in a century opportunity. You have the tools to disrupt education. And key trend, continue revolution. Everyone can be a teacher. Everyone can teach, right? Professor Bandit talked about the Khan Academy, the largest school on earth, started by one guy, right? And there's a digital effect, and there's tons of tools available to educators that has never been available or possible in the past century because of the technology. Right now, someone can teach, and then make a good amount of money doing Facebook Live. They just teach by Facebook Live. People pay them, and then they create a page. People pay them, create a closed group, and then they invite people to a closed group, and then they just live. I'm not meaning about business. Just from your cell phone. Okay, you buy a cell phone. Everyone has a smartphone. You're connected to the internet. You can be a teacher. You have something to teach. You have a very, very powerful, and it's not only that. There are tons of free tools for you to start education technology. And again, it's the whole value chain. Curriculum, teaching, content, delivery, and assessment. The whole value chain of education will be disrupted by technology. And that's a new professional environment as well. Because professional managers in the company, they have to adapt a lot. But then I have to say, this is sad truth. But university isn't adapting at the same pace as the professional environment. The company, they have to adapt so fast, and then they need to reskill, to re-educate their professional. This is a huge opportunity. And this is the education technology environment. This is this logo is the logo of the startup that tried to disrupt education technology. But then, sadly, in China, I have invested in 30 startup companies already in 1.5 years. Only one edtech company I can invest. Where is it? Big market, huge opportunity. But only one company out of 30 companies in education technology. 3 million baht that I put in, I have another 97 million baht to put behind this education technology startup. And this is growing, it's a huge mega trend. And I say this is the 6B of the exponential technology. I would say that we are now at the point of deceptive. Deceptive is similar to a fox wearing what? Wearing a sheep skin. We are now at the deception point of education disruption. In the next few years, it will be disruption. And everyone must be ready for that disruption. The people that are not ready to adapt or disrupt themselves will be disrupted. Think about what happened to the magazine industry. 5 years ago, people think that it's okay, don't worry, magazine will survive. And then what happened right now? Because when it reaching the disruptive point, it just just came off speedily like this. No one got prepared. Right now we are at the deception point. We don't see much of the disruption for education because we are here deceptive. But in the next 5 years, it will be a disruption for education. You want to be a winner, you better do it right now. You want to adapt, you better do it right now. Think about this. Professor Bandit already said, one man, one computer, 10 million students. Khan Academy is reinventing education for $1 trillion opportunity. Professional opportunity in the past, I want to learn because right now, if you study at the engineering, computer science, big data, that kind of thing, becoming a data scientist, it's so difficult to find a good program here in Thailand. But now you can learn it from Coursera. And it's so expensive to learn from John Hopkins, one of the top schools in the world. It's so expensive. $29. So expensive, $29. it's so expensive. It's about 6 cup of Starbucks. You can learn a class called Data Science Specialization that you cannot find anywhere in China from John Hopkins. And that's why the company in Colombia bought like an online learning company Linda for $1.5 billion. Why? To help professionals adapt to the changing environment. And you think about it, like, let's say that like right now, I'm an engineer, but I want to be like a marketing guy. In the past, what is the only solution? I take MBA in 2 years and several hundred thousand baht. But now, you learn from data, you can earn specialization and get certification in just less than half the cost and at your own pace. You can build your own career. And good university like Harvard Business School, and also like I think like a good university like Kellogg also, like I'm doing offering like MBA online, you know, like Harvard Business School, they provide like Harvard Ed, where everyone can learn MBA, can learn like business like administration from Harvard in life. Basically, like this is like a classroom environment, and everyone like joining from all over the world. And I participate. I was so curious. I said, like, would that be the same level as the traditional classroom education for MBA? So I took the class from MIT certification. And then, you know, like, I feel it's not the same at all as the traditional classroom education, but it's much better. Because why? The professor took the feedback that student posts in an online forum. He adapted the course real time. And then you can participate with your online community. You can change group. Rather than having a peer of only like 100 people, you basically form a community of 1,000 students all over the world. And at the same time, you do a project at your own pace. You don't need to, you know, like leave your job. You can do it at your own pace. So that's the power of online education. Company called General Assembly, you can pursue a career you love. They provide course both offline and online, you know, like basically like even a course like programming, designing, you take General Assembly course, you don't need to like you know come back to university anymore, but like from General Assembly, you can explore innovative courses in design, marketing, technology, and everything. And they even have a campuses worldwide as well. Like right now, we have Singapore and Hong Kong. So you take a course online and then go to the campus in Singapore or Hong Kong and then get the specialty in all these fields. And this got me the certificate from MIT from in FinTech. Because like, at first, like, I know that FinTech is coming, but I don't know where can I find the latest knowledge about FinTech. So I look around at MIT offers, I took that classes, and then I get a certificate at my own place. And you know what? Certificate from MIT, how much does it cost? $1,500. Only think about it. And not only that, for like Udemy, a company called Udemy, they partner with the company to create a courses that when people study and get the certification, they'll be a specialist and they get recruited to the company right away. So the company is partnering with the online education company, the edtech company, to create a courses. Google is doing the same thing. And the other company will follow suit. And you're not the only tech company. And many other companies in the future, they'll partner with existing university and also expert to create a courses to create a future employee for them or re-educate their employees. And what does the future look like? This is like the ending of my presentation, but I think this is like a very, very good example, the sum of everything. There's like an online, there's like the education platform, it's called Alternative School or OutSchool. What is it? It's actually like they believe like technology and knowledge, they are transforming society at an accelerating rate. But then they believe education, you know, is the most important for a young kid. So they try to change the whole education system for the kid by buying technology. So what do? They partner with educators, entrepreneurs, and engineers to create a platform, not only a technology, but the whole platform to help the child to deliver personalized learning so that the kid can reach their whole potential. You don't have like a course that is like cookie cutter courses for the kid anymore. Different kids learn differently at their own pace and find their own talent since at the young age. They work with school, they work with educators, they work with engineers. They are like creating a platform that everyone participates. And then they reach out to the traditional school as well. And then they create a concept called whole child education. So like, they teach the kid. In the past, they believe that the kid education is very linear. It's like, okay, you graduate from this, and then like you progress to like, like Adhuman 2, Adhuman 3, blah, 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 blah. It's very linear. But the world is not linear. And different kids have different talents, different interests. So rather than like, teaching the kid with standardized course, no, we teach the kid with what? With different grade, personalized learning. And then focus on this sociology, curiosity, phonemic awareness, geography, life sciences, and think about our country. And I go back to my hometown, what do they still teach? Okay, making handicraft, tak po. Okay, and I learn what? Kapi kapo. Is that important, really important skill? No, probably not. But this thing is more important. Problem solving, intellectual curiosity, persistent resilience. Look at the curriculum in Thailand. Do they have this word at all in the curriculum? Resilient, problem solving, self-direction, collaboration, ethics, coherent writing. Do they teach this in Thailand at all? Even the top school? No. We are falling behind a lot. And in this platform, they create a true personalized learning, They like they use an iPad and a tool so that like they can track. And each student, each kid, they have their own playlist. They don't call it a course, but they create a playlist for each student can personalize their learning as well. Like I said, the assessment, the course, the delivery is geared toward the kid. It's really like a child-centric education. It's not like in some country, like it's like actually acquired-centric, They have like a portrait so that a teacher can assess the progress of each kid in real time, and then they can adjust the curriculum to fit the progress of the kid. And it's not only that, they disrupt the whole value chain with this concept of alternative school. Learning design, learning plan, learning execution, assessment input, and process redesign is the whole value chain of education that this EdTech startup tried to address. Again, education is the most powerful weapon for changing the world. If you want to change the world, don't do another app, chat app, okay, I have like moving speaker, like disappearing speaker, don't do that at all. The best way to change the world and be remembered forever is by changing education, creating the future inventor, creating a platform that can empower the kid, creating the next Elon Musk, creating a technology that unleashes the potential of your students so that one day they can invent and change the world. Education is highly profitable, huge market, lazy existing players. Technology is ready. You have money as well from investors. Everything is falling into the right places. It's just about you. To really change the world through education. And again, I want to end this presentation with this. When we talk about EdTech, it's not really a tech. Technology is just a tool. And when we talk about like MOOCs, and all the buzzword, it's just tactics. It's just tactical. Education, disrupting education via EdTech, startup or any other way or disruptive solution, it come back to the basic thing. Student-centric, personalized and adaptive, community-based, teacher is just a coordinator. Teacher coordinator, learning is a strategy. Changing the world through education. Everything is ready for you to change the world. Thank you. ขอบคุณครับ
The team, and now I would like to invite Dr. Nacha to please give a token of appreciation to our guest speaker and also Dr. Madhu as well.